Oh no! Guys, look at this!
Ah!
We have a very serious problem. A problem I feared might happen, despite taking all measures to ensure we wouldn't ever have to deal with a crisis like this. These red tropical fire ants of mine are a species that, as much as I love, I also fear. Because I know at the back of my mind, every night as I lay down in my bed, that the ants are relentlessly looking for ways to escape whatever enclosure it is that contains them. That's just how tropical fire ants are. And they're a species I do not recommend to any new ant keeper for this very reason. As fun and cool as they are to keep, they're also hard to contain. Now, in the past, I've come close to full-out escapes. And there are a few things to do in case an escape does happen, which I'll mention in a bit. But in this case, there's a bigger issue here. What do I do now that I know this volcanic island paludarium setup we on the channel called Volcania, which was specifically designed and built to house my red tropical fire ants, we named the Crimson Knights, is not as escape-proof as I thought. I had so many questions that were stressing me out. From where were the fire ants escaping? Did they move out the queen already? Which would be really bad. Did they find a new nesting site somewhere in my home? Do I finally need to do the unthinkable and consult a pest control company? I'll be answering all these questions, but do stay tuned until the end because I'll really be needing your help, AC family. Bottom line, I cannot have a massive, ravenous, and stinging red tropical fire ant colony nesting in my home. So, some drastic measures are about to take place today. Okay, let's breathe. First things first, I had to address the point of escape. From where were the fire ants escaping? I followed the trail of ants along the glass platform on which a fire ant highway had now been established. Let's have a look. Aha! Here was their point of escape. They were not supposed to be able to access this area, though. I mean, theoretically. How were they getting here? And then, I saw it. The ant barrier. The fire ants, by some miracle, were now able to cross the talcum barrier aimed at keeping them in. If you're new to ant keeping, this band of white stuff is talcum, and it is supposed to be slippery when the ants come in contact with it. So its aim is to keep all the ants within their setup. It has been literally smothered and painted on every peripheral surface all around the volcanic island, and has for years proven to be an effective ant barrier in the hobby. But here the ants were, crossing it. But how? My guess was the humidity from the adjacent waterfall located nearby rendered the talcum barrier ineffective, something I did not anticipate would happen. I suppose one ant managed to make the crossing to freedom and went back to inform the rest of the colony. I looked at the point where the ants were able to make the transition from land to glass and was terrified to see the active trail connecting to the whole colony all the way back to the nest. Alright, now with escapes like this, before any knee-jerk reaction and taking drastic measures, I now wanted to assess the severity of this fire ant escape. Starting with the most critical question, did the queen already move out? This would be bad because the queen is essentially the grower of the colony, as she lays all the eggs, and if she was somewhere already hidden and protected in my home, she would definitely go on to amass an active colony, and I'd have a very bad fire ant problem. Normally I could just turn on the AC, and the ants would die, as they don't do well in cold. But in my home, there are just so many places the ants could crawl into and escape any air conditioning. Plus, many of my other ant colonies would also die. So my answer to the queen fire ant's whereabouts? Well, you see the trails? The colony hasn't chosen to move out the brood yet, In my many years of experience, I know a pet fire ant colony had indeed decided to initiate a complete nest emigration. Once we see that the ants had decided to transport the brood, i.e., eggs, larvae, and pupae. And as you can see among the trails here, the fire ants have not yet decided to do this. Thank goodness. Which to me meant this escape has happened quite recently. And most importantly, the queen and all the colony's babies were still residing in their mountain. Phew. All right, next. Did they find a new nesting site somewhere in my home? I followed the trail to see where the ants were actually going. They crawled down this pane of glass. And onto the rubber matting beneath the tank. The trail eventually led down onto the wooden tank stand. And all the way here. Aha! It's a crack in the stand. Checking the floor, the ants had not yet wandered that far down. Thank goodness. They had found some opportune crack in the tank stand, which I didn't even know was there, to be honest. I could see why they might like this spot, because it's dark, and more importantly, humid, due to the sump filter below. And the fire ants love both those conditions for their nesting locations. Now, red tropical fire ants are truly interesting, in that they aren't a nomadic species of ant, meaning their colonies aren't always on the move, like army ants or black crazy ants. But they aren't necessarily a stay-in-one-spot kind of ant species either, and have no qualms about picking up and moving out to a new location or setting up a secondary satellite nest if they ever find an ideal place to live. AC family, I think we found these escaped fire ants at just the right time, and it was now time to deal with the breach. So to address the question, was it time to call an exterminator? Most people would say yes, but most people aren't ant keepers. My answer is an unequivocal no. Having my place fumigated would kill not only all of our Crimson Knights here, whom we raised from just a single queen ant, with so much love, and watched grow up and eventually reach the milestone of moving into this grand kingdom home of Volcania, but it would also spell certain death to all of our resident ant colonies and critters on this channel. I would, for the record, never resort to an exterminator, nor use bug spray ever, no matter how bad my ant problem got. Especially in this case, which isn't as bad as it could be. And seeing as there are other effective ways to deal with ant escapes, which I will go over and do now. So normally I would simply vacuum all these escaped ants up. But AC family, some of you may have noticed that the ledge all around and matting and some glass surfaces have some white substance all over it. That is not talcum. So in filming these escaped ants this week, the footage you see here isn't the first time they escaped. They had actually escaped a few days before this as well. And I did vacuum the escaped ants up and tap the ants back into their setup. But as an extra measure, I also applied this, the chalk of death. Now, I have gone over this in previous videos, teaching you guys how to eliminate ants in a quick and eco-friendly way. It is called diatomaceous chalk, and it's composed of microscopic fossilized diatoms, which are little marine creatures with spikes. Now, once an insect comes into contact with the fossilized diatoms, it creates a bunch of microscopic cuts into their exoskeleton, which dehydrates them and eventually kills them within a few seconds. It is safe for us vertebrates and is non-toxic, but the substance is lethal to insects. It also is rendered ineffective once wet or when humidity eventually gets to it. So it isn't a permanent solution and needs to be replaced often. So after vacuuming the ants, I made sure to add some diatomaceous chalk all around where the ants escaped. But as you can see, it only worked for a few days before the chalk was rendered ineffective, probably due to the humidity of the waterfall again, and they escaped again. For this second time, I didn't want to vacuum the ants up and return them, in fear they would go back to the colony and inform everyone back at the nest that they had found an escape, that it was possible to escape, and that they knew where the breach was. This time, death of the escapees was the only option. So, with a heavy heart, I took the chalk and drew it all over the newly desired nest location. I drew it all over the matting. I drew it all along the glass and on the ledge. And I made sure to lay it on thick, this time over the area the trail was crossing, to finally cut off the trail before it progressed. And a few hours later, the fire ants were nowhere to be seen. All the ants that had escaped had died and fallen away. As sad as this was, I knew this was only a tiny percentage of the actual colony that had been eliminated. Plus, in nature, there would be predators, disease, lethal parasites, and fungi that would naturally keep a fire ant colony from unbridled growth. So perhaps a controlled culling of our Crimson Knights like this was indeed needed? I mean, they're eating raw chicken feet every 2 days. The population will just keep growing uncontrollably. But AC family, here's the deal. I feel this chalk is all just a temporary fix. We have a much bigger problem on our hands now, and it's stressing me out at the moment. Here is where I need your help. What on earth should we do next? It was only a matter of time before the talcum and diatomaceous chalk weakened again, and the fire ants begin to attempt an escape at the same place. For now, I'll have to keep applying the chalk every day to make sure an escaping ant trail never forms. Or do you think a controlled culling like this is necessary to keep the fire ant colony population managed? Or do you think it's time to move the fire ants into a new setup? One that wasn't so open concept, perhaps? And more like an enclosed tank, like our fire ant setups in the past. But I know moving the fire ants out of Volcania will be a complete logistical nightmare. So as much as possible, I don't want to do this. Let me know what you guys think I should do, and I will begin the plans on how to deal with our fire ants escaping. The fate of the Crimson Knights are in your hands.